Yes, well, next time I will wipe my hands with his robe. You would faint.
A Pharisee is so cheap. When he writes his will, he names himself as the heir.
And then he still doesn't get much.
No.
Finally, he's back.
Hello, Simon.
Stay with the sheep.
He is useless. Why do you keep him around?
He's a good boy.
You want some dinner?
Finally.
Aaron made dinner tonight, so nothing is cooked.
Yes.
The food is fine. It's my grandmother's recipe, so leave it alone.
Yeah, then that is why your grandfather left.
Again and again.
They take whatever they want.
Oh, I wish that woman wouldn't have left the well.
No, she was very,
very
beautiful.
Very pretty.
Can I have my dinner now?
Not with us. No. Your plate is over there.
After what happened this morning, you sleep with the sheep tonight.
And pay attention this time.
And watch out for wolves.
Watch out for the Pharisee. He might come after you.
A Roman took another sheep yesterday.
Simon, they're talking about the Romans again.
But they cooked it right in front of me.
You're lucky. You're lucky you're not part of this conversation. But Romans, again and again.
Expect them to pay. Good pay. They take whatever they want.
Let's talk about something else.
Thank you.
virgin shall conceive and bear a son. And shall call his name Emmanuel.
Luke chapter 2, verse number 7, says, "And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born in this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger.' And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.' When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us.' And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger." In this section of the record of Jesus' birth, Luke, who is a physician, is centering our attention on an interesting group of people, the shepherds. And perhaps you've noticed by now that's the theme of this Christmas service. Shepherds in biblical times were not a highly regarded group of people. They weren't thought of as very smart. I would get along with them pretty well by that regard. They were pretty rough around the edges. They didn't play nice with other people. They were thought of as on the fringe or the outcasts of society. But these shepherds that we're reading about in Luke chapter 2 were a different class or a different kind of shepherds. They were not your ordinary run-of-the-mill shepherds. Rabbinic sources such as the Mishnah indicate that certain fields southeast of Bethlehem were reserved as places where animals that were intended for temple sacrifice were raised. And these shepherds that we're reading about in Luke 2, the shepherds that are always populating the Christmas story, very quickly, by show of hands, did anybody happen to be a shepherd at a church Christmas pageant at some point in your life? Anybody else have, you know, like you wore a tablecloth or a towel or a bathrobe maybe with some kind of wicker basket or longer burger basket or something and a cane that accompanied you? Anybody else? Am I the only one that had that wonderful privilege? There are a few of us that are in that fraternity. Okay. These shepherds would have been trained by the priesthood on how to raise the perfect sacrifice, how to work really hard to produce the right thing that's going to cover and pay the price for sins. They would have been trained on how to be good enough and how to work hard enough to produce something that would make all of the mistakes and the failures and all of the problems and all of the mess ups and all of the disappointments of yesterday go away. What an incredible pressure rested on them, that they would have felt that and carried that, that what we do has to make the difference. What we're producing, what we're raising, what we're tending to, what we're looking after is making the difference for us, for our house, for our family, for the whole town, for the whole nation. And if you were Jewish, for the whole world. Man, there's a lot of us that know what that's like, that we're carrying this pressure to feel like it's up to us to make things okay for our whole world. That there's a lot of junk and a lot of stuff behind us, and we're doing everything that we possibly can to just make it all okay somehow. These shepherds were carrying a tremendous pressure. And the angel's announcement to the shepherds of a baby laying in an animal feed trough was more than just a birth announcement. It was God letting them know that the old sacrificial system was coming to an end. You see, every day the shepherds hoped that something in their flock would be acceptable enough to cover sins. They hoped that they had worked hard to keep it pure. They had done enough and that they had paid attention to keep the sacrifice spotless and that nothing was broken and that everything would be right and proper and acceptable. And this mattered because the acceptability of the lambs was not just about, it was not just a statement about the purity of the animal. It was a statement about the vigilance of the shepherds. And they wondered, did I do enough? Have I done enough to appease God today? Maybe you know what it's like to have that thought run through your mind. Have I done enough good to appease a holy God? Sure, I've done some bad. Sure, I've made some mistakes. Sure, I've messed up. But has the good that I've done, because I've done good, you've done good, right? You've seen the red kettle in front of Walmart. You made it go jing-a-ling-a-ling. You made it sway back and forth. You've done some good. You've helped some people. You've not said everything that hit your mind. Okay, maybe not that one, but you've done some good. And surely you've done enough good. You hope you've done enough good that would outweigh the bad. And these shepherds every day are hoping that they've produced something good enough that can make the bad from yesterday go away. Can I come up with something that can bring peace to all the problems of the past? And let me just insert right here and say that I know that you've wrestled with that. I know that you've wrestled with that. Can I come up with something? Can I find something that can produce peace for all of the problems in my past? I know that you have, because we all have. All of us have. All of us are right now actively wrestling as we are at Christmas, as we are coming upon the end of the year, as you hear that gloriously depressing Christmas song. So this is Christmas. What have you done? Another year old. It's like, you know, it's Christmas and you're a loser. We get to this point in the year and we're looking back. And for so many of us, you've been looking back and looking back and looking back and looking back. And you're saying, I just need peace. I want peace. What can I do? I'm trying to come up with something to get peace. And that's why I'm so excited about the series that we're starting on January 1st. That's all about helping you find peace for your past. That's why you need to come back January 1st. Because God has peace for your past no matter what's back there. No matter what's back there. I said no matter what's back there. God has peace for your past. And look at this. Then the angel of the Lord appeared on Christmas morning and said to these shepherds, I bring you. Can you, if you're in this room with me this evening, can you shout you? He singled them out. He said, I bring you. He didn't say, I bring to the whole world. He didn't say, I bring to the Jews. He didn't say, I bring to perfect people. He said, I bring to you. I bring to you, singular, I bring to you, to this group of people, the shepherds, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. The good news and the great joy will be for all the people, but I'm bringing it to you specifically. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This good news of God becoming man is for all the people. But God, listen, is taking the extra steps to make sure that they know that there is a message here just for them. God's taking extra steps to make sure that these shepherds, these priestly trained shepherds, know that, hey, there's a message here just for you. So what was it? What was all this heavenly splendor in a field over some sheep and goats? What was the message that God had just for these shepherds? What was this all about? God's message to them was this: faithful shepherds, you don't have to tend this flock anymore. You're being downsized. You are henceforth unemployed. You see, those shepherds would work really hard and find and produce an acceptable sacrifice that a priest would take and offer up, only for the priest to return and need another one, and another one, and another one. That no matter how perfect of a job that the shepherds could do, no matter how vigilant they could be, no matter how watchful that they could ever be, the best that they could do would be to find something that could only bring temporary relief. But Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And the message that God had the angels bring to these shepherds is that no longer would man be needed to work really hard to come up with something that would just bring temporary relief, because the perfect sacrifice wouldn't come from the hands of man, it would come from God Himself. You see, God was not content with man's best efforts only producing temporary relief. But God's heart for you, and God's heart for you, and God's heart for me, and God's heart for everybody is that you and I live totally and completely free and cleansed from every sin and every stain that would ever touch our heart. That we don't live seeking the consolation of the temporary relief of good works and good deeds, that we don't live seeking the temporary relief of alcohol or substances or food or online shopping or rendezvous with relationships, that we don't live just seeking temporary relief that can numb us from our past, but that we know that there is a place of complete and eternal and permanent cleansing and deliverance from who we have been, who we will be apart from God, and His name is Jesus Christ. And He didn't just come. He didn't come as a full-grown man just to make a visit for a few seconds and to pronounce judgment. He came as an innocent baby, lived a complete life in all that it means of human existence. He suffered, He hungered, He felt sorrow, He felt rejection, He felt pain, He felt loneliness, He felt loss, He cried tears, He was tempted, the Bible says, in every single way that you and I can be, yet without sin. He didn't just pay the price for our sin in a day and drop His sinless, spotless blood and descend. No, He lived to be the example. He lived to provide power. He lived to let us know, I know what you are going through. I'm here. He didn't just take on flesh for a moment. He is still flesh. He's praying for you. He's interceding for you. He's cheering you on. He's encouraging you right now. And for those of you that have yet to cross the line of faith, for those of you that are thinking about it, for those of you that have been wrestling with God for months or for years, or for some of you in this room right now, you've been wrestling with God all of your adult life. He's saying, come on, come on. Lay down your stubborn pride. Come on. Come on, what are you waiting for? Come on, come on. You're not so far gone. You're not so deep. You're not so sinful. You're not so mean. You're not so hateful. The message to the shepherds then, you're unemployed. There's a better sacrifice. And His name is Jesus. The message to the shepherds in this room who feel like it's all on you and you just got to be perfect and you just got to be good enough, and you're thinking, before I really give my life to Christ, I got to clean myself up. Before I really get in church, I just got to be super holy Mr. Ninja Christian guy. There's a better sacrifice. His name is Jesus. And the message from the angels of heaven to you today are, you've been downsized. The sacrifice of you is not necessary. Jesus is better. Now think about that. If you're that shepherd and you're those shepherds that we saw in that video, and heaven just comes to let you know, your job is over. You're unemployed. A baby is taking your place. How are you going to respond? They ran to see Him. I want to encourage you right now. Some of you have spent your whole life running away from Jesus. You've kept your distance from certain family members. You've kept your distance from certain friends because you thought it was all about them, but really it was about the Spirit of God convicting you. And you've been running away. But tonight you need to follow the example of those shepherds and run to Jesus. You made yourself a promise. There's somebody in this room. You made yourself a promise. If the Spirit of God tugs at my heart one more time, I'm going to get right with God. And here in this room, you've been feeling that one more time. It's been a long time since you feel that, you felt that tug down in the pit of your belly. But that's the Spirit of God. That's the Holy Spirit saying, come home. And you need to follow the example of those shepherds and run to Him. Stop running away from Him and run to Him. Can we all stand together across the house of the Lord this evening? I want to ask, as every head is bowed across this room, eyes are closed, and we're being respectful and reverential to the moving and working of God on people all across the auditorium right now. The word says, the shepherds said one to another, let us make haste and see this thing. That's just a fancy way of saying, come on, let's get out of here. Let's go now. Let's go now. Let's go now. Right now. Right now. There's nothing more important than getting to Jesus right now. There's nothing more important than getting to Jesus right now. Sir, ma'am, there's nothing more important than you getting to Jesus right now. There's nothing more important than you giving your life to Jesus right now. God's orchestrated this whole moment, this whole evening, this whole event, for you to follow the example of the shepherds, for God to let you know. It's not about you finding things to bring temporary relief. It's about you receiving His perfect sacrifice for your life. And run to Him instead of running away. There's some shepherds in this room that right now, this is your moment. And I know there's at least one that you made a promise to God, and this is your time to follow up on it, that you said, God, if you will not give up on me, but you give me one more chance. If I could feel one more time what I felt in my younger days, and you went off and you've lived the prodigal life, but now you're sensing that pull of God on your life one more time. He's visiting you again right now, and this is the time for you to come home, for you to run to Jesus right now. Very simply, if you're in this room right now and you're ready to say yes to Jesus, I want to run to Him just like those shepherds ran to Him and found Him in the manger at Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. Right now, I want to run to Him and say yes to Jesus. Instead of running away, I want to run to Him and give Him my life, and I want to be born again here this Christmas season, 2022. Jesus, I want to give you my life, and I want to receive yours. I want you to very simply just lift your hand toward heaven. We're going to pray, and one of our team members is going to come and stand next to you and pray with you, and we are going to see heaven transform your life this evening. Right now, lift your hand high. We're going to pray. Today, I'm ready to run to Jesus right now, just like those shepherds. Praise God. Praise God. This is your opportunity, sir. This is your opportunity, ma'am. Praise God, back there in the back. Somebody else. Somebody else. God's not giving up on you. God's not giving up on you. In everything that has happened, He's not giving up on you. In all the highs and the lows and the ups and the downs, He's not giving up on you. And all the good, the bad, and the ugly, He's not giving up on you. Praise God. Praise God. Hey, can we pray this prayer together? Lord Jesus, thank you for coming to me when I was in my stubbornness, in my rebellion. You continue to chase after me. Thank you, Lord, for your Spirit. that has been in this place tonight. I receive your grace. I receive your goodness. And Lord, I will, with every opportunity, I will run after you. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of this Christmas. Help me, Lord, to always prioritize your presence in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Can you give God some praise this evening? Amen.
Wrapping up the year with a special legacy offering. We talked about that about 6 weeks ago, and we asked you to pray and seek God about what you should give at the end of this year. And there's a few buckets that our legacy offering is giving to. One is the East Kentucky Dream Center, and they are pouring out some amazing blessings in our community right now, especially at Christmas time, and we want to be generous toward that. We're also giving toward the Belfry campus, which is launching in 2023. I'm so excited about that community. It's already there. It's just waiting on a service to begin. And so I'm very excited about that taking place very soon. And then also in the next year, we want to begin to just go out into the community more and more and begin to do outreaches all across Appalachia. You know, when we talk about this time of year and we talk about gift giving, you know, it's so easy to talk about giving because God's gave the best that he had. And he showed us exactly what that looks like, to give our best. And so I was thinking tonight, I kind of just looked at John 3:16 in a different version. And, you know, it opens with, "We know love by this, that he laid his life down." And I think about us knowing love only happens when we give. We know love because of giving. We know the goodness of God through giving. And you know, there's a lot of different types of gifts that we can give. We can give the, I call them the low relationship gift, the low quality relationship gift giving, which is the general things that you just pick up at the store, the bar of soap, the Bath and Body Works. We may not know each other that well, but everybody can be blessed by something like that. And then you've got the kind of gift giving that happens when you know the person a little more and there's a relationship there. And so you invest a little bit more, maybe of your money or maybe a little bit more thought into the gift. And so it means more. And then there's the kind of gift that's like, it's the gift you could never repay. It's the gift that it's a treasure. And that sometimes might not even have costed very much. It might be something like taking your grandfather's clothes and reworking them into a pillow that's at your home. Or it took a lot of thought. It took a lot of love behind that gift. And guys, I want to encourage you tonight that when it comes to gift giving, it's not always about some high dollar amount, but it's about a value and a thoughtfulness that exists on the inside of us, that we're choosing to give of ourselves, that we're choosing to take part in a giving opportunity that we can. And so I want to encourage you. You may be sitting there thinking to yourself tonight, when it comes to a legacy gift, something that will outlive me, you might be looking at that dollar amount that you have to bring to the table and be saying, that's not what I would call a legacy gift. You might be thinking a legacy gift, something that would outlive me or outlast me, looks like a whole lot more. But guys, the thing that will outlive you is your generosity of heart. And by us coming together in this room, that legacy offering can be so much more by joining together with our church family. So I want to thank the Connection family who makes giving a priority, and you make it a part of the natural rhythm of your life. And you give of tithes and offerings all the time here. And that's a big deal because we could not be reaching Appalachia without you. But I also want to thank everybody who's choosing tonight to take part in the legacy offering, because there is so much more left to give in our community. There's so much more love to be revealed to the hearts of people and to show the goodness of God here in Appalachia. And it's through generosity like yours that that's going to make such an impact and such a difference in this coming year. I want us to just pray.